just to understand the typical characteristics of Livonian Middle Ages. It's not like European Middle Ages, it's really a bit like more harsh, not that elaborated buildings that it is in Europe. And so you can see one of the masters of the Livonian order, and so the city that you are right now here is Riga. And here in this model, you can see the development of Riga. So first of all, it was a place where the Livonian peoples were living. You see here, these buildings are log buildings. And then came the German merchants who started to build the stone buildings. And as there were a lot of fires inside of the city walls, there was a law that the wooden buildings are prohibited to be built inside of the city walls. And so gradually only the stone buildings were built inside the city walls. At the end of the 13th century, Riga reached the, so to say, the border of nowadays what we call the Old Riga. Most probably the majority of you have been. So the streets are there covered with cobblestone. You see some very old buildings, some replicas of old buildings. But for those of you who have been to Tallinn, so there's a very good feeling of the medieval city because of the city walls that have been really in very good condition and have been kept until the 21st century. In Riga, we see only the powder tower and the construction of this city wall here. Nonetheless, there are three buildings that have survived for sure with some changes, starting from the Middle Ages until the 21st century. That is St. Peter's Church, so the very high spire. You can take an elevator and have a look at the Riga from the bird's eye view. Riga Dome Cathedral, a very beautiful concert hall nowadays as well, not only a church. And St. Jacob's Church is next to our Parliament House. And so you can see also Riga in this drawing, just to see the main churches. So the St. Jacob's Church is there. Riga Dome Cathedral still having the Gothic spire, and St. Peter's Church, so the high spire nowadays. And the Riga Castle nowadays also stands there, but that was already built in the 16th century, so you see it's outside the city walls. And so Riga was a Hanseatic city, Riga was a German city, as the main inhabitants of the city were the German merchants, followed by the German clergymen, and also with the German military persons, like first of all the sword brothers and later the brothers of the Livonian order. And then 500 years ago, the new belief, the new faith came here to Livonia, and that's the Lutheran faith. Until then, so the Catholic faith. When Martin Luther brought his new faith, the Reformation started. And Livonia was the second that took the Reformation. And it's interesting that the Lutheran faith will be leading in the western part of Latvia and the central part of Latvia, not in the eastern part of Latvia. And even nowadays, if you ask people which church they go, most often it would be the Lutheran church. Next hall is dedicated to the period, the 16th, 18th century, so the period of three wars, the period of changes. And so the first war was the Livonian War, when the last of the masters of the Livonian order, Gotthard Kettler, became the Duke of the Duchy of Courland and Semigalia. But otherwise, the whole territory of Latvia was under the power of Rich Pospolita, so Lithuania and Poland together. And that is why you saw the symbol coming already inside this hall, a very big weapon that was used in major of these wars. And as the Rich Pospolita or the Poland-Lithuania got the whole territory of Latvia, also the Swedes wanted to have some territory, and that's why they started the next war, the war between the Poles and the Swedes. And they got the northern part of Latvia, called the Livonia, and also they got the biggest port, Riga. And at those times, Riga was even bigger than Stockholm, and they really good income to Sweden. And only starting from this period of time, we can start thinking about slavery in this territory of Latvia. And so starting from the times of the Swedish war, this territory of Latvia, nowadays called Latgale, was starting developing differently. Here the Lutheran faith was leading, but here the Catholic Church will be leading, and it will happen and go on, continue until the 21st century. The third war was the Nordic War that started in the beginning of the 18th century. At the end of the Nordic War, the Russians invaded Riga and the Livonia. And then the Reich Vospolita was divided, and in 1772 the Latgale was joined to the Russian Empire, and one century later, only in 1795, the Duchy of Courland and Semigalia was also added to the Russian Empire, and only after this, again, Latvia was under one power. As you see, different powers changing, and here all the territory under one power. Nonetheless, the war times, but you see that the local people are working very hard, and they are putting their wealth in the hoards, and so this is one deposit that was found already in the 20th century, but it is dating back to the times of the Nordic War. And then there comes kind of peace times until 1812, it's already the 19th century, when there was a rumor that the Napoleonic army is going to invade Riga. And to have the place where the Russian army could settle, there is a law that all the wooden buildings should be burned, so the army, Russian army, can have a space where to settle. And so you see how Riga looked like before the fire and how it looked like after the fire. And as Latvia is a part of the Russian Empire, you see that our men also were fighting in the lines of the Russian army. And speaking about the cities, Riga was still a German city, nonetheless the powers were changing, but it was a German city with the elite, the people who had a lot of land inside of the city walls, with the rich merchants organizing in the big field, and also the craftsmen that were organized in the small field. They all were Germans. Speaking about the local people, so here you can see a drawing depicting the local people. And so starting from the Swedish times and going on in the times of the Russian Empire, so the local people became the slaves. So the slavery started. And so the slavery system was active here until 1861. It is a year when the slavery was abolished in the whole Russian Empire. But in Kurzem and Vidzem it will happen some years earlier. So speaking about the local people, so the 16th century is a time when we can start speaking about Latvians. Until then we will say Kurelians, Semigalians, Aleonians, and Livonians. But in the 16th century, we don't see any differences between their accessories, and also their languages is coming closer, and so they are choosing one dialect to be taken as a founding stone of the language. And so that is why the 16th century is the time when we can start speaking about Latvians as a nation. And so again, you see an influence of the European culture and European accessories. And speaking about the slavery period, so that is a time when people are working very hard to work on the lands of their landlord, and no one really cares about the education, except for the clergymen, because the clergymen want to be understood on the Sunday mornings when they are preaching, and that is why they are going from farmstead to farmstead, and just testing do the children know how to read, how to write, and how to count. And the main things that they want to know is the Holy Bible, that they're testing, do they know the fragments of Holy Bible by heart. And so these two showcases tell about the major faiths in the territory of Latvia. So the Lutheran Church will be leading, even now in this period, 16th, 18th century, and even nowadays. And the Catholic faith only in Latgale. And maybe some of you thought, why not the Orthodox Church is leading here? Because as I told you, Riga was a German city, the merchants didn't change their faith, and also the noblemen, as they were Lutherans, they didn't change their faith. And so the slaves, so the peasants, they didn't have any right to choose their faith. So if their nobleman was Lutheran, then all the peasants were Lutheran as well. Next hall is quite tiny, but it is dedicated to the Duchy of Courland and Semigalia. And so this is the same period, the 16th, 18th century, and one part of Latvia. So if you take the Riga Dalgo here, and it is the left bank of the Riga Dalgo, and that is the Duchy of Courland and Semigalia. And it is really differently developing all the time, and it was the last that joined the Russian Empire. So you see the first Duke of the Duchy of Courland and Semigalia, Duke Kettler, and he started the Kettler dynasty, and during his grandson's times, Jacob Kettler, this Duchy of Poland and Semigalia, it had really very good ships being built here in the Duchy of Poland and Semigalia, various manufactures being made here, and so actually everything that was needed for a ship was made here. And if you have such good fleet, you can also have colonies. And at those times, Duchy of Poland and Semigalia had colonies not only in Africa, but also in South America. The island of Tobago once was a part of Duchy of Poland and Semigalia. But unfortunately, the last of the Kettlers, Friedrich Wilhelm, didn't have any children. And so Anna Janovna had to choose the next dynasty that would be following the Kettlers on the throne. And she chose the Ernst Johann von Biron, so you can see the next dynasty. And so they are the last of the rulers of this Duchy of Poland and Semigalia. So he and his son Peter, they were the last who ruled in the Duchy of Poland and Semigalia. And here you can see they were the major development was an economy. But here, as you can see, the main thing was prosperity, how to show off. And so, for example, to have a set of porcelain made in China, built really beautiful palaces, as the palace of Rundale, if some of you have been there, it really look like palaces in France, and also the palace in Jelgava. So that's how they showed off. And also you see the portraits, that they really look like French kings, right? And so the next hall is dedicated to two various lifestyles, so the lifestyle of the nobleman and the lifestyle of the peasant. Let's go there. For example, here you can see the Kazdaka Palace. But the peasants who were working on the fields of the noblemen were living still in the log building. So it was a traditional way of building. And so it was really very hard work, starting from early spring until late autumn, working really very hard, because the noblemen could really have a very prosperous way of life. As you can see, hunting, and the women were singing and embroidering, being at home. But because no worries about life, as the peasants will do all the labor. And next is a way of life of the local people, of the Latvian peasants. And so you can see it's really still the slavery period, working really very hard. As you see, the working tools are very primitive, and really everything is made by themselves. The only thing that they can't do, they order from the smiths. Otherwise, they really do everything on their own. And so the majority of grain or whatever they have, they give to the landlord. So that is this the system of slavery. And as you see, that they could also they should also gather the hay for the domestic animals to survive the long winter time. So this is flax, a plant flax that is grown incidentally in Latvia in every farmstead because of the clothes that is made from this material. And so here you can have an insight into the peasant building. So again, the log building, and that is the main living room of the one family. You see it's really very tiny, and you see the main object in the tiny room, it's a weaving loom, as all the clothes were made by the women themselves. And in the second part of the 19th century, the wardrobe enters the interior of the peasants as well. Until then, all the items were kept just in wooden boxes. Speaking about the musical instruments, so you can see the wind instruments and string instruments that will be worldwide. But this string instrument called kokle, it will be something very local. And this would be of Latgale. And this would be of kurzeme, like two different types of the kokle. And you can have also, you can just do a push play and have a listen to the sound of kokle. And next we'll have a look at the festive clothes made by housewives themselves. But in the end of the 19th century, when these costumes were collected and also the reconstructions of these costumes were made, as you see, a lot of things are already bought in the market. But nonetheless, we can divide five ethnographical regions. So this is our ethnographical national costume of the Latvian nation. So this region would be Kurzeme, so one of the parts of Dacia, Kuland and Semigalia. Really very well off, and really the people were more well off than in the other territories of Latvia. The next ethnographical region is Zemgale, the other part of Dacia, Kuland and Semigalia. The third part is Wijewardana, so the Livonia. And so again, you see that there are not only the Latvians living, but also the Livonian people still living there. And again, the same, looking back in the archaeological costume, not having the head ornament, but just a piece of cloth item. And then the fourth region is Latgale. So you see these three costumes coming from Latgale. And Latgale is a region when the flax is grown in really very huge quantities, even nowadays. And so this white color, this grayish color of the flax, natural color of the flax, it would be very characteristic to Latgale region. And the fifth region is Augšzeme. And so you see